I'm hidden. I'm stepping away, though.
Cool.
She's protecting you from me because I'm very dangerous.
You know what, David? This is so interesting, though. I've been watching your interviews for years, but because you're never on camera, I have no idea what you look like. Now I do.
So how are you?
I am well. I'm good. I found my way back to LA after taking a bit of a sabbatical last year. And it's nice to be back.
Have you been here through the whole mishigas of the pandemic, or are you a relatively recent returnee?
No, I haven't. You know, I mean, it was kind of been an interesting journey. I know we have been shooting, you know, we shot Mortal Kombat for a good part of the second half of 2019, you know, kind of drifting into 2020. And then all of that happened. And then I went back home to visit family, which is Singapore. Mm-hmm. And as you will, you know, things happen and I, you know, one thing leads to another and, you know, I'm there for 6 months and then it was time to come back to do, pickups for, Mortal Kombat. And that was also when they figured out how to, you know, quarantine and how to, have those protocols for, a film set, which is actually amazing in itself, you know.
Well, it's been very successful so far, it seems. Some of the TV shows that shoot on lots have had some problems, but the hour-longs and the movies seem to have figured it out pretty much.
Yeah, it's a system, you know? I mean, it does change things. We get tested about, you know, twice, three times a week, and, you know, and then the whole set is kind of partitioned in ways and set aside in ways that are, you know, that are very... I mean, it's like being in a sci-fi movie, really. You know, I mean, all these sections, you know, concentric circles, you know, ground zero where you're shooting, and then it spreads outwards that way, and different levels of protocols will be, you know, implemented for different sections of it. So it's very it's very rigorous.
Yeah. So how did this, you've been doing this, you are a major, major star in Asia.
You
are not as well known here in America. You're not as, you know, you're not a, but you are like a god over there, it seems. am I exaggerating or just embarrassing you?
You are embarrassing me. I think it's been quite the ride. You know, I think, you know, to have the kind of time that I've had here in Hollywood has been, you know, surreal to say the least. Mm-hmm. You know, to have my first studio movie be The Dark Knight, you know, is quite the first movie to have, right? I mean, I think it's wonderful in some ways and very tricky in others, because it's wonderful because, you know, I mean, you know, it's a friend of mine actually said it, you know, he said, like, look, I mean, you're at the Super Bowl, you know, first time out, you know. And I didn't know what he meant, you know, at that point until after I finished shooting the film. Mm. You realize that you're working at the highest level with the, you know, at the highest levels of production, even. It's not just the actors and the director, but I mean, you know, even in terms of design and script writers. So it sets the bar, right? I mean, and then you go on your merry way, you know, to other movies thinking that that's the norm, you know, that's every movie that you're going to be doing from now on. And obviously, yeah, you know, I mean, that's, you know, it's not the reality.
So the idea of doing American movies or Hollywood movies enormously appealing to you? Did they come find you and from your other work and then, you know, kind of bring you in? Or were you interested in coming to Hollywood and being part of this thing?
Well, I was directing and producing theater when, you know, I got the call for The Dark Knight. And so, no, it wasn't an active pursuit. You know, I think I was at a point in time in my career where, you know, I had other creative outlets that I was looking to satisfy, like to direct for theater. And I love directing for theater because it's so contained and there's so many elements, you know, that are within immediate control, you know. And then obviously as an actor's medium as well, the stage, and I love working with actors. So it was such a nice time for me. And it was a good 8 years, I think, I was directing and producing stuff between, you know, like really acting on something and, mm-hmm. and being in The Dark Knight. So, no, you know, I mean, I think The Dark Knight happened. And then after that, I don't quite know where they find me, but they find me.
Well, it's funny because, like, Billy Friedkin, William Friedkin, the director, the last 15 years of his life had been mostly doing opera.
Yeah, you know, I mean, I love that, right? I mean, I don't know if you know this guy, who a British guy, you know, years ago, and he's a doctor, and he wrote this medical book called The Body in Question, Jonathan Miller.
The great Jonathan Miller.
Yeah, and you know, he also directed opera, right? He directed operas, and he directed, stage theatrical productions in the UK as well. So I always thought that was such a nice way to, you know, apply your craft, really.
So how did you get into all of this in the first place? Were you interested in acting, or were you interested in martial arts, or were you interested in, how did this begin for you as a kid?
I was fascinated with the movies. I think, so I grew up in Singapore in the 70s, and you know, we got our independence in the 60s. So in the 70s was a very busy and very interesting time for Singapore. I mean, it was a lot of industrial development, and the city was being built into the city that it is today. But in terms of the arts, we weren't, it wasn't a hub, you know, for the arts in Asia anyway. I mean, at that point it was, more Hong Kong, right? I mean, you would see Hong Kong movies and you know, Golden Harvest, Shaw Brothers stuff. And I think, you know, I mean, in that kind of environment where, you know, you don't, movies were the only kind of outlets. You don't really go to, you don't have that much theater at that point, because it was still in its nascent stages, and it was still being very experimental and doing a lot of very interesting things. And so the movies were where, you know, I went to indulge my fantasies. And I was very interested in films even from a very young age. You know, my mom says it's maybe because she watched a lot of movies when she had me as well. She was carrying me, and she's a movie buff too. But I love the movies. I remember, this was very young though, I think I was 10, and they were actually very bohemian in the sense that, you know, I mean, they would, you know, kind of warn me about certain movies that I want to see, and whether they, you know, there were things in there that might be disturbing or, you know, troubling for a child, but they wouldn't stop me from going to any of these films, you know. Mm-hmm. So for example, when I was 10 or 11 or 12, you know, I told my parents, you know, that movie looks very interesting, I want to see The Exorcist. Not quite sure what it is about, but I want to see that movie. and
how did you come out of The Exorcist? Did you love it? Did you hate it? Did
you think it would be freaking, oh my god. Yeah. Well, it was really great though, because my parents said, okay, we're going to go with you. We're going to sit by you. Mm-hmm. You know, you can just put your hands up if it's too scary, or put your hands to your ears and we'll cover your face as well if it's too much, you know. Uh-huh. And we had a system, and it was all very interesting. And when I went in, and it was deeply disturbing, but in Singapore, we do have a, you know, at that point in time, we didn't have a censorship board, and they would censor your movies. So you know, you get it very chopped up, you know, whether for language or for imagery or for, you know, I mean, stuff. So even in its censored stage, it was incredibly disturbing. But that was the kind of exposure I had, you know. It was Sophie's Choice. You know, I would be 12 years old and I said, I want to see Reds. I had no idea what that was about, you know, but I just loved the performances. And I was like, I don't know what this thing is, the communists, I don't know, you know, such an interesting time in American history. But as a 12 year old, you can't quite grasp, you know, the mechanics of all of that stuff. But, you know, they never stopped me. It was Tootsie, and then it was The Godfather, and it was all that great stuff, you know, before I even got to Star Wars, you know. Mm. I was watching all that you know, that stuff. So that got me interested in the movies, and I just felt like, you know, I wanted to be doing that stuff. I wasn't even sure what part of it I was going to be in, you know, but I just thought that would, that's such an amazing way to live a life.
So how did performance come into your life? Did it just, jump in, or did you train?
Well, I started, I think I started as, you know, I did not, train, but I started actually, you know, kind of dipping my feet in when I was a teenager. So, you know, I studied all the usual things that a good Asian boy would study, and math, science, you know, physics, chemistry, you know, kind of prepping for possibly a career in medicine or a law, which was, you know, the thing that everybody wanted to do at that point. And so that was how I spent my days. And you know, I was also a competitive swimmer at that time, but I was always, that never left me, the interest in you know, creating. So I kind of dipped my feet in, you know, to quite a few theater productions where I would like audition, and then I'll get the part, and then I'll say no to it. And then I'll audition, and I'll get the part, and then I'll say no to it. I just kept...
You stop getting auditions that way.
And it was very interesting because I did that. And then, you know, I got a sense of like, okay, maybe I can do this. You know, this is something I can do. And then finally, you know, I auditioned again. And it was for, I think, the Singapore Youth Festival, one of the plays at the Singapore Youth Festival. And then I got it and I said, okay, I'm not going to say no this time. I'm going to do it. And I did it. And then that led me to, you know, other plays, and then, you know, doing professional theater, and then into television. I mean, it's all very truncated at this point, but I mean, it did spread over quite a few years.
Did you fall in love with acting, or were you just enjoying the entire immersion in the arts?
I love the immersion. I love the escape of it. You know, I think Singapore is a wonderful country, and, you know, rich in history and culture and food culture. But, you know, I mean, it is a small place. And, you know, I think as a young person, my mind always wandered to other places, you know. I mean, even not even in just movies, but, you know, reading books, right? Reading the books of Ernest Hemingway or Somerset Maugham or Evelyn Waugh or any of these, even Enid Blyton, you know, I mean, the Famous Five. I was like, I wish I could go on one of these adventures. And then in America, it would be the Hardy Boys, right? I mean, right. I think Nancy Drew. So it was a wonderful sense of escape that I felt when, you know, when I was acting. And then after that, you know, that's how it started. But after that, you realize that there's so much more to it, you know, in terms of like self-expression, you know, and you know, helping scripts that help you figure out your own lives as well, you know, while you're living it. And so it became more of a passion. And as I went on and worked with more directors, then, you know, you start honing your craft, and every director comes with a new set of techniques that they, you know, that they kind of directly or indirectly infuse into you, and then it became a career, basically.
So is Mortal Kombat a movie where you feel very directed?
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, it's a remarkably stylized piece. It's an interesting, it's very, I mean, I actually really like the movie because it's really simple, but everything he does is beautiful. He really, the image is a lot of it. And then everything is really clear and clean in terms of storytelling and the performances, the acting, and the style is fascinating. Yeah.
And that is a direction as well. You know, I mean, I think simplicity is a direction. You know, I think What is interesting was last night they had just launched Benjamin Wallfish's soundtrack album for Mortal Kombat, and you know, it was so interesting. I mean, he was online and he was gonna, you know, interacting with all the people who were listening, and I realized, you know, for movie in terms of like the characters and the plot lines and the stuff, the soundtrack was incredibly complex, you know.
Yeah,
I think, you know, and you know, it was kind of so mercurial, and he kind of used so many different instruments and was, you know, changing the beats and the rhythms of the piece that you know, I think a movie like Mortal Kombat is deceptively simple because of what you see. But I think in terms of the layers of like soundtrack and production design and costume design, there's a lot of moving parts in that movie.
Oh yeah. No, I don't think I don't mean to suggest there's anything easy about anything he did. Oh, no. I mean, the director came from advertising.
Yeah.
And it is, you know, in the ad world, you have 30 seconds and, you know, you spend a fortune to make everything perfect.
Yeah.
Within that, whatever your vision for it is, even if it's meant to look casual, it's an act of perfection most of the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
So is it does doing a show like this fun for you? Is it, you know, is it an interesting aside? How does it fit for you? And because you have a complex career.
Yeah, I think every movie, you know, scratches a different kind of itch, you know, for me. I think, you know, and this is timely now, but Contagion was massively satisfying, you know, I think in a very different way, you know, with Soderbergh and Scott Z. Burns' really labyrinthian screenplay. I don't know if you ever saw the original screenplay, but it's like it's you know, it's quite substantial. And then the film, you know, the film as we had shot it originally was quite epic as well. I think it was, you know, I think the first cut came in at 3 hours, and then eventually you got an hour, you know, a movie that was about an hour 45 that moved like a freight train. But that scratched an itch for me because I had, you know, experienced SARS as an epidemic back in Asia in the early 2000s. And, you know, it was kind of cathartic for me. So that, you know, that satisfied that. The Dark Knight was a fascinating time, though. I mean, I think that particular comic book hero was, I think, the most interesting, you know, of all the characters that were being explored at that time, I think, in film, because, you know, he was human and he was, you know, and he had to rely on a very different set of skills, really, and intellect to be a superhero, so-called. So that was actually a boyhood fantasy come true. And, you know, I mean, to be honest, I mean, that was the best gift I could give my brother, who got married that year. So that was kind of a wedding gift for him because he loved it. He introduced me to the Dark Knight. He was the Frank Miller, you know, he introduced me to a Frank Miller graphic novel. He introduced me to The Long Halloween and all those other things. And, you know, so, I mean, that had meaning for me personally. So as for Mortal Kombat, you know, I think it was interesting because I had just come off of Skyscraper, and that was a wonderful time, a lovely experience, you know, a somewhat visionary, heroic kind of role. So I, you know, after that, I just wanted to, you know, kind of switch it up a little bit, and was looking for an interesting villain to play, really, to be honest.
So you want to just change it up?
Yeah, yeah.
Roll the role?
Yeah. And I wanted to do something that was darker and, you know, and then Simon came with this script and armed with, you know, armed with all this concept designs, right, for costumes, for production, for music, for, you know, I mean, he's such an interesting director in that sense that, you know, I mean, he's very sharing, right? I mean, he will come and he will share everything. There's some directors who don't, right? I mean, because, but he comes and he shares all of it with you. And he says, and then he's like, he tells you, you know, very clearly how he's going to shoot the scene. So for example, you know, I wasn't sure about the violence in the film because, you know, I'm not entirely a fan of violence for the sake of violence or, you know, that kind of torture porn stuff or, you know, I mean, that kind of, or the, you know, the kind of Italian films that Argento used to do or, you know, so, things like Hostel. I mean, they're very unnerving for me. So I, you know, I had to ask him the question as to how violence was going to be portrayed, you know, in this film. And I remember him telling me about how, and I asked him specifically about the scene where, and it's in the trailer so I can talk about it, where Jax's arms are ripped off.
Yeah.
And, you know, and he told me how they were going to do it. And he told me how he was going to set them up and how, you know, what stakes are there for every character. And then, you know, I mean, that kind of made me feel better, you know, about signing up for this film. And I did, and I'm happy I did.
Had you ever played the game?
Yes, I did. It was the arcade, and the arcade games are so cool though, right? I mean, I think...
the old days.
Yeah, the old days, right? I mean, but you know, the thing, the toggle and the buttons, and what's interesting is that you never know, right? Because at that time, you don't even realize this, but at that time, because you don't have the internet, you don't, you know, you can't really, you don't know what the special moves are. No, there's no manual that goes like, you know, A, B, back, forward, yeah. C is the special move, right? You don't have to. You're just randomly pushing buttons and suddenly you get some amazing move and you're like, wait a second, what did I just do? I mean, I don't. And you know, the whole process of the playing in an arcade is that, right? I mean, it's just a voyage of discovery, really.
When I play with my 11-year-old on Xbox or whatever, he tells me that I'm spamming, is the phrase that he's using.
Oh, is that what?
I'm just pushing buttons. I don't really know what I'm doing. So I'm just spamming him, apparently. That's the new thing.
You and me, I think, is our generation, I think. That's what we do. Yeah.
Well, you know, when we start almost any new game where it's a killing game, my wife and I both have faster fingers than he does. So we beat him for the first few times, and then he figures out how to play, and he kills us all constantly. You know, we're done.
Wait, how old is your son?
11. Well, it's amazing now. They have these games online. He plays, you know, what's it called? Roblox. Yeah, Roblox on the computer. And it's all like you need to know codes and you need to know this stuff. And he has it all down the same way kids learn the button moves on the, you know, computer game or on a video game.
You see, I had no idea what the, you know, the gaming world had evolved to until, you know, I did more research when I got Mortal Kombat. But it's endlessly fascinating to me that they can have these arenas, right? They'll put up, you know, I mean, they will book out Madison Square Garden,
yeah,
or something like that, and then people would all go to the stadium, and then right in the center of it is just two guys are doing this and a giant screen. Yeah. I guess that's the future. I have no idea.
Put them on TV even. There actually was a very highly rated, I think Madden 20 or something. They had two guys playing each other on TV, and it got like one of the biggest ratings of that week.
Yeah. No, it's
insanity.
It's crazy. I mean, I remember the Singapore Symphony Orchestra had put, you know, was playing, they had played a concert of game, you know, of, I
game
think
music?
game music or something. And, you know, it's hard to sell a concert, you know, with Tchaikovsky and Beethoven, but, you know, game music completely sold out. Right. So
do you, so when you're in LA right now, but are you going to go back and do some theater? Are you kind of like, is your idea of the next decade of your career mixing it up between the different things that you've been doing, or do you have a focus thing that you want to do?
Well, that's the thing though. I mean, I think my career has been, I mean, on you know, from the from outside, it looks like it's is, you know, wonderfully curated and very thoughtful, thoughtfully planned. But to be really honest, I mean, I actually do a movie at a time. So, I mean, when a movie is done, and I consider a movie done when it's released, right? So for me, the journey with a movie starts with, you know, being cast or, you know, the meetings that you take with the director until the day it opens, you know, I think. And then once it is out to the public, I feel like it's gone, you know, it's disappeared, it's gone into the ether. Mm. And until then, I actually don't really think about the projects. So it's kind of interesting that way. And it's kind of worked out. And so, I mean, I'm just, you know, sitting pretty and haven't quite decided what I'm to do next. But I do have a sense that, you know, I'm would like to start working and looking into writing a bit more and possibly directing very soon.
So you don't have next project anxiety like a lot of actors seem to, sounds like.
No. I make good use of my time. I'm a very productive, idle person. Mm.
So has that made the pandemic? I know, I mean, in doing these interviews through the last year, mostly writers have been happy through the pandemic because they actually got time to write and to come up with new ideas and actually focus. Is that true for you as well? Or?
Well, I've been, you know, I do this, right? I mean, I don't, I know how writers sometimes have this routine and they say, set aside 2 hours, write, even if you have nothing to write, just write it, right? So 1 hour, 1 hour, 1 hour, and 1 hour. I'm like, I'm different that way. You know, I kind of soak it all up, you know, until it's completely saturated my brain, and then I write. So I think this past year, I've been reading a lot, and I've been reading, you know, I've been reading a lot of sci-fi, really. You know, I've been reading the sci-fi short stories of Ken Liu and Ted Chiang, who wrote Arrival, right? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that stuff has been firing up my imagination. That stuff has been interesting. But, I mean, it's the same way I kind of approach, you know, roles as well, characters when I'm acting. You know, I don't really... You know, some actors, when they get the script and they have a highlighter and then they just highlight everything, all their lines. And
yeah.
And that's the first thing they do. And then they go through it and go through it. I don't do that. I don't touch it at all, basically, my script. My script is, if you saw my scripts over the last 30 years, I mean, they're the cleanest scripts you could ever find. You know, so I basically just read it, and then I read it, and then I read it, and I read it, and I read it, and I read it, and I think about it, I think about it, I think about it, until it gets so saturated. Mm. And then I start dissecting it and breaking it down and looking at the stuff.
So do you like being directed?
I do. I enjoy that very much. Yeah. Mm.
So you don't want to just come in with what you have in your head? You want to participate in a group activity of...
Oh, I come in with stuff in my head. Right. I come with stuff in my head, but, you know, I mean, I like being told because, I mean, I think, you know, with a movie, especially when you look at the big ones, right? I mean, even something like 2012 or Independence Day Resurgence, you know, I mean, I think these films, and, you know, I've worked with Roland Emmerich twice, you know, these films are so massive that I have to trust your director to have a sense of the bigger picture, right? Yeah. I mean, if you're bringing to him something that another character is already bringing to him, then it's not going to work, and we're going to have to kind of find a way through this. So, you know, I think that they have the full picture, and, you know, I think I will bring my 2 cents, but I think ultimately I will defer to whoever is directing me.
I always remember when Werner Herzog explained doing Bad Lieutenant, Port of New Orleans with Nick Cage and a bunch of other good actors. And he said, everybody was on script except for Nick. Nick could do whatever he wanted. That was his role, was to be wild and come up with things. And everybody else was like strictly required to stick to the book.
Yeah, that's one way to go.
Yeah, it's a very interesting, it's a kitschy movie, but it's a fun movie in that regard.
Yeah, but don't you think, like, you know, I mean, I think That's kind of cool because everyone else is controlled, but he's the loose cannon in there. But you know, when they do these Judd Apatow movies, right? I often wonder, like, when everybody is riffing, right? How does that work?
Right.
You know,
Yeah.
there's almost no straight guy. You know,
Everybody's a comedian.
everybody is a comedian, you know? I mean,
Yeah.
and
Well, I think
so.
it's a lot of takes is the main thing that what I've been able to get from Judd and from Seth Rogen and others who've done these things is that a lot of, you know, the script is they do the script and then they do eight other takes where all these funny people get to kind of try out their stuff. And then some of it makes it and some of it doesn't make it.
Well, you know, I'm kind of old school, as you know. I mean, we're both into spamming, you know, in video games, but I'm kind of old school. So I started out in the theater, right? I mean, I think the words of these playwrights are very important. I mean, whether it's Shakespeare or Moliere or Patrick Marber or David Mamet, right? I mean, to me, the words are. The words are everything. I mean, very important to me. So, improvising is a lot of fun. But you know, I always, you know, I have a soft spot for well-written movies. I mean, for example, like or very wordy movies. I like, you know, I mean, and I always think I'm a weirdo because you know, like for example, Mank, right? It was so incredibly dense and wordy, but I enjoyed it, you know. I mean, it's like Hamilton as well, right? I mean, Hamilton is such a magnificently constructed musical, but you have to pay attention, you have to listen to the stuff. You can't, you know, kind of just sit there and then, you know, drift for 3 minutes and then come back and, you know, you kind of have to pay attention.
But watching Oldman kind of work his way through passages. I mean, I guess it's been like that forever in a way with
Yeah.
him, but it's one of the great joys of watching cinema is watching Gary figure his way out through, you know, I actually watched some of The Professional the other night,
Yeah.
and there are these, you know, there's these chunks of dialogue in it which don't really, you know, everything else is very quiet, and then there's Gary Oldman like killing it with like 2 pages in 1 minute and a half, and you know, he
Yeah.
managed, he figured out how to do it. He knows what he figures out the lyrical element of it.
Yeah, I mean he's so masterful at it though. I mean, yeah, it was such a it's a lot of fun to work with him on The Dark Knight. I mean, that was one of the great pleasures. I mean, we didn't have too many interactions, but I mean, whatever we did was just awesome.
So when the movie opens, or do you have a thing that you do? Will you pay attention to the numbers or to the, I mean, I guess it'll be challenging with it in both theaters and on HBO Max, but do you pay attention to all that stuff? Are you interested in that at all?
Well, I mean, I think you know, you can't help but be kind of curious about it. I think that's the word. Interest might be too strong, you know, a word for it, but I'm curious about it because you do want to know how it lands, right? I mean, you play a particular character, especially a character like Shang Tsung, you know, that is so iconic. I mean, the way, you know, Carrie did it 25 years ago. And we're going with a different take, as you have seen the film, you know. And you know, I mean, there's a fair amount of risk taking, and I think with any amount of risk taking, you know, I'm curious to see how it lands, you know, and that would be one of the reasons why, you know, I would be watching the numbers.
You
And
read reviews?
reviews are tricky, right? I mean, I think that even regionally they're different, right? I mean, I think the different countries, you know, sometimes I've been in films where sometimes, you know, particular countries are like great, crazy about that movie, right? I mean, I think like, for example, Ghost in the Shell, you know, and which I did. I mean, the Japanese loved it. Some European countries loved it, you know, but then you come stateside, and then you know there's a lot of different kind of criticism of it. But you know, I mean, that's to be expected, right? I mean, you put out a creative piece, and you know, different people from different places respond to it differently because of how they are and what you know where they come from. But so I mean, it's a tricky thing to to read, because, you know, if you take the good, then you have to take the bad as well. Mm-hmm. You know, that's just, you really just have to go with that. If you're a little squeamish, you know, I think you shouldn't read reviews at all.
Yeah. Or any, you know, comments on the internet.
But the comments are the comments are, man, the comments are the it's you know, that's a dangerous place to be. Yeah. Because, you know, I mean, I think, again, you know, it is so immediate, right? I mean, there's no sense of, sometimes that you don't get the sense that of contemplation with these,
yeah,
one sentence comments or three word comments, or and then, you know, that could ruin your day, you know, after.
Well, I do it with the interviews. I will look at the comments every once in a while, and somebody will say something that's just mean or whatever. It's like, and sometimes I'll respond and explain what it, you know, the thing they didn't like, maybe it's the way I do them specifically. Like, they don't like the conversational thing. They want it more the traditional way that they've seen it. And I'll say something, they're like incredibly apologetic when they realize another human being is responding. And it's not just them speaking into the void and, you know, being tough. Some people stay obnoxious, but a lot of people will just, you know, like, oh, I didn't quite realize that a human being was going to pay attention to what I said.
Oh, isn't that funny? Wouldn't it be great if, you know, if you had to put a comment, I mean, just to remind people that there's a human being on the other side, you would have to put your photo, your birthday, your birth date, your address, and, you know, before you could put a comment. I think that would humanize everybody.
Well, I know for me, that's been my rule for myself for 20 years or whatever it's been, the internet, that, you know, I do not, if I'm going to say something mean, I'll say it with my name on it. Well, usually say it to the person. I have no interest in like hiding and attacking, you know, it seems so, if you're a professional, I guess, if your profession is having an opinion, which mine has been for a long time,
yeah,
it's kind of cheesy and cheap to take shots from the peanut gallery, I think.
Yeah, you know, I mean, and the same goes as an actor, right? I mean, if your profession is to be an actor and to make choices, risky or otherwise, then, you know, I mean, if it's going to land one way, it's going to land one way. If it's going to land another way, then it's going to land another way. You know, I it's very hard to explain your choices or to justify them. You know, the only thing is, like, I'm sorry you didn't enjoy the movie as much as I did making it.
So. Well, Ghost of the Shell was a good example where, I mean, I don't know that I loved the movie, but I did. I thought it was certainly got overly beaten up in the press in the United States. And there was obviously the issue of Scarlet and all that and being American, being, you know, white. But there was interesting stuff in the work. I mean, there was interesting stuff in Aeon Flux years ago also that, you know, also had problems with that. But it's hard to fight City. Once people get their mind in this idea of what something is, it takes 5 years later, all of a sudden they start changing their mind.
Well, I mean, isn't that the case? I mean, isn't that the case for all these films, right? I mean, I think, what was it? What were some classic movies that...
Well, the Kubrick films always, the Coen brothers films get this all the time.
Yeah, and Blade Runner was one of these movies.
Like Kubrick actually pulled 2001 out of theaters for a while and then recut it a little bit and then put it back.
Yeah.
The only hit Kubrick ever really had was Dr. Strangelove. Everything else took a few years to become a classic.
Yeah.
You know, they all kind of started as soft, either bombs or not very successful movies. And then 5 years later, 10 years later, they became movies people wanted to see over and over again.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, it's one of those things, right? I mean, the film will have a life far beyond, you know, our own. So I'm not, you know, something that maybe doesn't resonate at that particular point. It might resonate, you know, at a later stage. And for example, again, I mean, the movie Contagion, if it was released today, I mean, I think would have struck a different nerve, I think, than when it did open in 2011.
But it was so great, even then. I believe Contagion should have won Best Picture that year. I'm a big Steven guy, but I love that movie still. I think it's a brilliant. I watched it, of course, at the beginning of the pandemic, like so many people did. All of a sudden became a hot movie to watch again. And it's still brilliant. It's just, it's a very smart movie, period, from beginning to end. Beautifully acted, beautifully shot.
Yeah. No, I mean, it was a great experience. I mean, I loved, I mean, I don't know if you've, have you spoken to Stephen before?
No,
have you?
Not for the, for Contagion. I never, actually, I spoke to Scott and then Scott apologized because Stephen wasn't doing anything at that moment. Stephen doesn't really like doing press very much.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't and like being, we actually did a full interview with him for, it wasn't for Contagion. I don't think it was the movie after that, but it was, we shot only his feet. That was our agreement, because we shot his boots. So my camera person got on the floor and just shot his feet through the thing, and because he doesn't like being on camera.
That is, what a great story. But yeah, you know, so Stephen, yeah, Stephen is great to shoot, great to make a movie with, you know. I mean, he's also the DP, so he has control over the, you know, entire
cutter. And the editor.
And the editor too. I mean, he has total control over the medium, and not because he is, not because he's that, but he's very collaborative. But I mean, it's so wonderful to see. Like, I remember we were shooting in, were we shooting in Chicago and Hong Kong? And I think we would shoot the day, and then at the end of the day, you come down to the bar, you know, hotel bar in the evening, and then you see them, you know, Gregory Jacobs and Stephen, and they're sitting in that corner, and you know, they have this corner set aside for themselves, and he's kind of cutting the thing together already, you know. I mean, whatever we shot in the day, you know, it's such a an auteur. Yes. Yeah.
Well, thank you for your time. It is much appreciated, and I really did enjoy this movie. I'm amazed how much I enjoyed this movie, but maybe it's because of the pandemic and it's just like some sort of relief to just have a clean, old fashioned, you know, it is in the, almost like a Shaw Brothers movie in a way, just like on point. It's not trying to do other things. It's just like going straightforward, which I love. And it's beautiful.
Yes. Yeah, it's so singular, isn't it? I mean, and I can't, I mean, we won't get into spoilers or anything, but that opening sequence, I mean, it's like a Takashi Miike movie, right? I mean, it's like, or, you know, there's just so much about it that's so elegantly composed, you know, I think with that film. And yeah. Hats off to Simon and Jermaine.
It definitely sets it. It feels like you're different. It feels like playing the game. You're in different places. Like it's another whole nother place that's completely different atmosphere, one after the other, which is like the feel of the game, which is great.
Yeah. No, I'm glad you enjoyed it, and I'm glad you showed it to your 11-year-old as well.
Yes, I'm sure he'll be watching it again before, as of in next week, I guess, he can start watching it again. Between that and Marvel movies and TV and God knows what else he's doing. Mostly he wants to play video games. You know, it's before, I'm a little older than normal parents of an 11-year-old, so I'm 56, I had to think about it. So I grew up without, you know, the internet or cable television, much less the internet and games and all this stuff. So it's fascinating watching him grow up in all of this.
Yeah. I mean, I think this is for a different conversation altogether, but I mean, the video games are really changing the way we process stories, isn't it? I mean, and I don't know what the future of film is really, because of that. I mean, we'll see. But in the meantime, it was great talking to you, and you know, keep on spamming. And
I will spam as fast as I can, trying to survive another night with my 11-year-old. Thank you so much. Pleasure meeting you.
Thanks, David. Pleasure.
Sure. Bye bye.
Thank you.